Welcome to this short video series on integrating technology into the classroom. I'm Mike Pasco, and my assumption is that you've already gone through the first objective video, which was how do you integrate technology into the classroom, and you're back for more. You're back now to see some demonstration and examples of integrating technologies, and some that I use now and some that I plan on integrating in the future. And then following this video, we'll move into how to become informed of upcoming technologies after today. So what am I using now and what do I see potential in using in the future? We're going to go through kind of rapid fire here, several different types of technology. The first of which is point of view or POV media production. So this is very useful in instructional video creation. There's a lot of opportunity in anatomy education to create some really rich media, specifically in terms of video format. And oftentimes these videos are created with an external perspective. So I'm suggesting that there's something unique about the first person point of view perspective. And now there are several technologies that will enable for the kind of the capturing of this perspective. And some of the first ones were things like a wearable device, like a Google Glass. So Google Glass had a great run during its first iteration. Google kind of let it peter out and die off, and there's all kinds of rumblings as to whether or not it will come back. But essentially, you are seeing the mounting of a high-resolution video camera onto the arm of a wearable pair of glasses. And Google Glass is unique in that there's a visual display. There's a little prism here that allows the wearer to actually see and play back what was recorded or access video and images that can be found on the internet, as the Google Glass does have an internet connection. So that would be a very unique way of having information directly in front of you that could be used during dissection, for example, and also to just record the first person point of view. GoPro has been around a little bit longer. The Hero model is in its sixth iteration. So there are some examples of anatomists mounting GoPros to themselves as they're doing some tasks to offer that first-person point of view. And now we come into the Snap Spectacles, which is kind of like a spin-off on Google Glass, except with the Snap Spectacles, you don't have a heads-up display. You're just looking through your typical kind of sunglasses, but there is a camera on the right side here. And it does do high definition, HD quality, as well as really good audio. And, you know, it's basically going to be transferring the information to the Snapchat app on your phone, which we're going to talk about a little bit later. And so we're talking about brevity of recording with Snap Spectacles. The typical length of a video, or I should say the maximum length of a video on Snapchat is 10 seconds. So that's what you're going to be collecting using the Snap Spectacles. You're going to hit a little button on one of the arms of the device, and then that will begin the 10-second countdown of video capture. So what these devices represent is kind of like a redefinition of a task. So you're going to be creating and producing content. Then you'll be able to edit the video, whether it's within Snapchat or within other video editing software on your laptop or desktop. But this just allows for a significant redefinition. Imagine giving your students these devices, or leveraging the fact that many of your students will soon have these devices, and they could then be assigned activities where they're meant to go out into the environment and record them doing a certain task for the instructor to then review at a later date. That's point of view media production. So the application that I've tried couple of years ago at this point was with Google Glass, going into cadaver lab and performing some cadaver dissection. So this was really productive, really good quality, excellent videos that could definitely be used in many ways. And one of the ways in which those videos were incorporated or used, I should say, was within a new dissection guide. So we're now moving beyond the time where the technology is a substitute, like Microsoft Word, where instead of replacing a printed dissection guide with simply a digital version, we can use multimedia with products like iBooks Author, where now everybody can be a multimedia document author and integrate really nice things like really nice photos and some of these videos that can be created with first-person point of view. So mounting a scalpel blade onto a handle is a very novel task for many first-year anatomy students. So actually seeing what it's like to put the blade on from that view that you will have of the device can be really beneficial. So here's just an example of the type of video that could be integrated within the iBooks document. Another really powerful class of technology that I integrate is cloud services. So there are several different types of providers that essentially synchronize your documents and your content in the cloud to then be accessible on many devices, essentially all your devices. The one that's really been doing it for a long time and doing it really well is Google Drive. So I definitely recommend you guys take a look at Google Drive. If you've got a Gmail account, then you already have some quota of disk space on Google Drive. So what I use Google Drive for example, with my anatomy teaching is my anatomy lecture slides. So it's really advantageous for me to be able to edit my lecture slides across all the different environments that I'm in. So if I need to edit something when I'm in cadaver lab and I don't have my computer out with me, I can go ahead and use one of the lab computers to edit some slides. I can do this while I'm in my office. I can do this while I'm at a conference, sitting in on a session about a specific region of anatomy. I can check, you know, what do I have on that lecture on the carpals? Do I describe them in this way? Do I list that ligament? I can go ahead and check in real time, and I could do this from a tablet or, you know, any internet-capable device like a smartphone. Then there's also the significant task redesign of sharing and collaborating. So almost all of my students, when they are tasked with putting together group presentations, use Google Drive and Google Slides, so that way every member of the group can contribute their work within the same document. And there's just no more awkward emailing of documents and version 37, version 38, version 38A. You just get around all of that by having your materials in the cloud being edited at any time by anyone. And you've probably done this in your own experience. And I also use Google Drive for real-time active learning opportunities in the classroom. Now, this is with a Google document. And essentially, what you can check right now, we're going to look at this in the in-class activity on October 9th. But what you're going to do is you're going to go to this short URL, bit.ly, an at review, all case sensitive. It all needs to be lowercase. And you'll see that what loads is a Google document that anybody can edit. So this is very valuable for me as a teacher to get a sense of what information students are bringing with them to class. So when we do a review session in my anatomy courses, I will put this document up and we'll do a think, pair, share exercise where I will have the students come to class with the top 10 concepts that they think are going to be on the exam that week. They'll share those with their classmate, and then they will pick up the top 5 of those to put into this collaborative document. And then this document becomes populated in real time, so I don't have to call on students. I don't have to write on a whiteboard. It's just way more efficient and way more interactive. And then I can go through and I can curate, I can debrief, and I can evaluate what the students are telling me, what they think is going to be on the upcoming exam. It's been a really helpful tool to use. And I should say that one should consider integrating social media into the classroom experience, because social media can provide the following benefits. It can extend discussions beyond the classroom. That's what I want you to do with this set of instructional videos. If you have a question or if you want to share something with me that I haven't considered in the classroom, there might not be time for that. You might not find that it's the right time to put your hand up and mention something, or you might be somewhat of an introvert and not really sharing things in class is not really your thing. So what you could do is you could turn to social media, you could have your students turn to social media, and you guys can have back channel discussions using these multiple platforms. So it really is a great way to increase student engagement between the instructor and the student, but also with the content, because what the instructor can do is in their established social media channel is they can be providing a lot of information, and they can be providing example questions. And that would just give the learner another opportunity outside of class to engage with the content. And this really just speaks to this underlying principle of meet the students where they are. So social media, right? That's the assumption. Students are on social media. But when you think about it, and when I've examined it further, Twitter really hasn't been the place where I find my students. So I put hashtags up for all my lectures, and it just doesn't really seem to happen with health profession students, with graduate students. They're not on Twitter. So you just have to find out where the students are. And once you find where they are, I promise you, it's a lot of fun, and it's a real good way of engaging with the students, and it's a real good way of just giving them opportunities to learn. And if you're interested in a little bit more about social media and modern human anatomy, I've put together some slides that are on SlideShare. The link is available, and you can go ahead and like Google for this, and you can find this presentation where I'm giving you a little bit more about social media and modern human anatomy beyond what we have time for today. So where are the students? Twitter was a dead end. Instagram seemed to be like a pretty good place to go, but that just took a lot of time. Instagram is known for, you know, posting really good pictures and not posting very frequently. You're kind of posting the best photo of some experience that you're having. You don't want to, you know, go overboard with Instagram. So I found that Snapchat, although it's been around for quite some time, is really where many of my students are. So instead of maybe, you know, 10% of the students being on Twitter, it's something like 95% of my students in my previous anatomy course were on Snapchat. So what I chose to do is I chose to create an anatomy-themed social media account. It's very rare that I put photos from my personal life. I do that every now and then just to, you know, add a little humanistic. There is an actual person behind this account, but mainly with this Snapchat channel, it's all about anatomy. So some examples of that would be telling a story. I mean, how beautiful. They're called Snapchat stories. So you can totally leverage the fact that human brains are wired to pay attention to stories, and you can tell a story in Snapchat using a sequence of video snaps or just static photo snaps. So here in this story, I wanted to review some bony landmarks with my students. So what I did is I started off with a snap of the internal aspect of the skull, and I asked, can you spot the foramen magnum? And, you know, give the maximum of 10 seconds, and now you can do a snap for an infinite amount of time. And then the next snap, whenever the learner is ready, is going to give the answer. And there's so many great ways to annotate images and videos within Snapchat that is just really a great platform for this. And the one kind of interesting thing about Snapchat, though, is it's kind of like an anti-social network, right? So I don't know how many followers I have per se. I don't know who's following me. The content disappears within 24 hours. So there are a lot of different ways that you can get your social media account kind of indexed and searchable and findable. And this is a platform called Snapdex. So Snapdex. If you're already doing this and you just want to, you know, get yourself out there as somebody that's snapping for these different reasons, you can submit your Snapchat account on a Snapdex. And so I did that for my Anatomy Snap account because I could tag my account with all of these other handles just to allow people to find me better. People can rate the content, comment, kind of just let me know how I'm doing. And it's social media, right? Like that, there's no way that's educationally sound. Like, why would you even waste your time? Well, I don't know if you realize, but there is a good body of peer-reviewed literature that supports some of the decisions that you would make on integrating social media into your class. So one recent paper was kind of asking the question, like, what is so unique about Snapchat and what makes it so great? So they asked a bunch of students about their perceptions about social media, and it turned out that the students rated Snapchat interactions as the most enjoyable. So this was compared to like Twitter and Instagram and Facebook. So there's just something really unique and special right now about Snapchat. So don't forget that you can do a little background digging into social media principles on PubMed, on Google Scholar, and you can find some really good backup and rationale for integrating this technology into your class. And with Snapchat, it really the authors really just seem to conclude that users are reporting that they attend to the Snapchat content more closely than your traditional social media type. Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, it's all archived, it's all searchable. But with Snapchat, you know, aside from taking a screenshot of something, the content is really here and then it's gone. So people are paying more attention and closer attention to Snapchat content. So it's almost considered as like more sticky for the mind. And so that might be a reason why you choose to explore integrating Snapchat into your course. Okay, jumping to another category, video conferencing. This is really good for cloud-based meetings. You might integrate this into your classroom when you want to bring in a guest speaker, but you don't have the budget to fly them in. You can send them an invitation using this platform called Zoom, and you can pipe them in, and the quality is excellent. It's very easy to share and invite people to these meetups. You can do conference-type calls where multiple people pop on. It's just an amazing platform, and you guys need to be aware of it because we all have access to this tool using our UC Denver login credentials. So you'll go to ucdenver.zoom.us to check that out. And it looks great on mobile. It's in your App Store, your Google Play. It's just, they do a really great job of cross-platform integration. So the experience is amazing no matter what device you're using, as long as you have an internet connection. Now let's get back to the wiki. This was our example of like redefinition. Remember the SAMR model, where we're totally constructing an experience that was not conceivably possible before the technology was in place. So you're going to want to go ahead and go to denversom.wikispaces.com to check out the School of Medicine wiki. This is what the homepage looks like. And essentially, the problem that this solves is, you know, every class is going to have a Facebook group where people are sharing study guides, they're sharing objective definitions, they're sharing drawings and videos, and that stuff just gets piled on, and the stuff from the beginning of the unit is always at the bottom, and it's hard to find. Searching is not without its flaws. So what the wiki solves is that problem of how to organize content in a manner that is good for people in that class to be able to find it, but then it's a very effective way of passing the information on to other disciplines within the campus and also between classes. So once you start navigating the wiki, you'll start to see on the left-hand side that somebody that was looking for modern human anatomy resources could click on that section and then find themselves on the modern human anatomy page. And then it's just a matter of submitting a request to join the wiki really quick and easy and then clicking the edit button. So once you click the edit button, editing a wiki page is almost like editing a Word document. It's very easy. You can do bullets. You can just type in some text. You can add hyperlinks. And let me just back up here and show you how, for modern human anatomy, there's some room for adding content to this wiki. So you can put some content under the first year. Within the spring, there isn't really anything for the fall yet. We should work on that. But for the spring, there's resources for learning neuroanatomy. So here you can see these are some resources that people in your specific course have found helpful in learning neuroanatomy. You can also click on the history, the little clock here, just to kind of look at the history of edits. And when I clicked on that, I'm seeing a name that looks pretty familiar to me. I bet I could guess who that is. That looks like maybe somebody that is involved in some aspect of modern human anatomy, and they have contributed these resources to the wiki. So it's a very powerful platform that allows anybody, even the instructor, to contribute some content. And it's all modifiable. You can add a discussion. You can have feedback. Somebody could type in that one of the links is broken, and then people would be notified and things could be changed. So that's the School of Medicine wiki. It's hosted by Wikispaces. You should really check it out and I think we'll be looking at it in more detail on October 9th. And Wikispaces is just one of, as I mentioned earlier, several wikis that you may be aware of, and you probably use to a great extent, such as Wikipedia. And I did want to say a couple things about Wikipedia in relation to anatomy education. So let's just establish how huge Wikipedia is as a website. It's ranked number one in the category of general reference websites. And Alexa, the firm that ranks popularity and traffic of all the websites across the world, ranks Wikipedia as the number five busiest website on the whole internet. And that's current as of today. There's 40 million articles within the corpus of Wikipedia, spanning 299 languages. That's like 10 more than last year. They just keep being added. And Wikipedia gets 500 million unique visitors each month. And a recent publication found that 47 to 70% of physicians and medical students report using Wikipedia. So that number is only going to grow. I'm sure many of you use Wikipedia as a starting point for researching various topics in your anatomy education. And the question inevitably becomes, like, how good is Wikipedia? How accurate is it? So in this report, and the references will be at the very end of this video series, where scientists compared the Wikipedia encyclopedia to Encyclopedia Britannica. And this is what they found. Wikipedia comes close to Britannica in terms of accuracy of its science entries. This was a Nature investigation. Reviewers identified an average of 4 errors in each Wikipedia article and 3 errors each in Encyclopedia Britannica. So this was not statistically significantly different, so what you would expect beyond chance. I would take this as Wikipedia is just as bit accurate as Encyclopedia Britannica, and if it isn't, then Wikipedia could easily be corrected and fixed in real time. Vandalism and people changing things intentionally to be misleading, those changes do not persist for very long on Wikipedia, and there are bots monitoring the articles, and some of the more important higher profile articles on Wikipedia are only allowed to be edited by people with certain permissions. So I would consider Wikipedia as being a very good reference for scientific information. And there's even a concerted effort to assess and improve the quality of Wikipedia in terms of anatomy. So you're going to want to Google the Wiki Project Anatomy. And when you go to that Wiki Project page, you'll see that there are places where you can do all kinds of things. If you're interested in editing Wikipedia, you can look at the Manual of Style. There's a priority ranked list of things to do to improve Wikipedia. There's some tools to help you edit, discussion, there are alerts for certain articles, and then there are many resources as well, such as where are we at in terms of the quality level of anatomy articles. So I don't know if you realize this, but Wikipedia articles can be ranked by their quality. So your front page featured articles, those are the best. But you can see in terms of anatomy, there are not that many of them. But these other levels, there are quite a few, and Stubbs are going to be the most populous of the quality of Wikipedia articles. And that's okay, because Stubbs begin their life as text taken from Gray's Anatomy. So the public domain, early 1900s version of Gray's Anatomy was moved over to Wikipedia. So it's an already refutable, really good start for a lot of the anatomy content. And then on Wiki Project Anatomy, you can answer interesting questions like, what are some of the most edited articles related to anatomy in the last 7 days? Okay, so you can see that hair has been edited quite a bit. Hopefully it's one of those articles that's moving its way up the quality index. And there are activities that could be undertaken with your learners, like a Wikipedia edit-a-thon. So essentially, you get everybody together with their internet-capable devices, and everybody collaboratively works together for a couple hours on building the anatomy Wikipedia Encyclopedia. So this is great because it's great for building relationships within your class. You might choose to do this within a community of learners, but it certainly works well within a class or within a program. It's a great opportunity for editors to learn from each other. It can convince people to become new Wikipedians. You know, I'd be surprised if anybody in this room, or excuse me, anybody that will be in the room, but anybody listening to this right now has edited Wikipedia, because it's something like 1-2% of all Wikipedia users actually edit that content. So you'll have to let me know using the hashtag if you're a Wikipedia editor, or you can, you know, talk to me face to face. But if you've got a bunch of learners that are new to it, going through an edit-a-thon may convince them to contribute more of their knowledge to the Wikipedia. And it's just a great opportunity to improve the quality of Wikipedia, because you can access offline materials and experts. So when you host an edit-a-thon, you can do it in a library. You can have all kinds of valuable resources and materials that are not found in a Google search. And you can have faculty and other content experts in the room that have a real area of expertise that can contribute to what is missing on the encyclopedia. So, when will the Modern Human Anatomy Wikipedia edit-a-thon take place? Stay tuned. Let's jump over to another category of technology, polling. So polling can be integrated in the classroom for the purpose of quizzing students, just kind of giving them opportunity to or practice retrieving information that might have been learned in a previous session. And it can also be used as kind of a formative pause within a lesson to check for comprehension. So there's a lot of concepts in anatomy that upon first pass, you know, they are just really hard to understand. So it's really good strategy as you're going through that first pass through the brachial plexus and how the spinal nerves network to form the peripheral nerves. Pause, give a question, and ask the learners to demonstrate their knowledge. So these are my favorite, this is my favorite platform, I should say, Umu. It works really well. This is a web-based polling platform. That's where they're all going. In the past, you could buy a whole box of these manual clickers, but that's really being phased out because in most learning environments, students are bringing internet-capable devices and they're bringing them charged, they're bringing their chargers. Like, the logistics are just so much easier with web-based platforms. So with Umu, you create your own account. If you're an educator, you get the professional level for free. So you get all the bells and whistles, all the features. And then at the beginning of your session, you show this to your students. This unique 6-digit code is attributable to your session and all of the quiz questions that you've generated. I don't know if anything is going to be live for this one, but you can point your phone at this QR code and you can scan it that way. Snapchat has a QR code reading function. I don't know if you recognize that before, but you can scan this, you know, take a picture of it with the Snapchat, and then it will link you to this URL. But it's also a really short URL, so your class can just punch these characters directly into the browser and go from there. And there's a lot of flashcard options. So we're talking the lower level of Bloom's taxonomy, but there are many web-based options for flashcards. So you could consider this kind of like a substitution level on the SAMR, because you're going to be replacing a stack of index cards with a digital stack of basically digital cards that can be flipped through. Brainscape and Quizlet are really doing a good job. And Brainscape does something really interesting. I'm sure Quizlet does it as well, but it does adaptive learning where it recognizes which of the terms or which of the cards you are getting incorrect most frequently, and it will present those to you at a higher frequency. So it will adapt to your performance. And likewise, the questions that you get wrong or you get correct very often are not ones that need to be visited as often. So you'll definitely want to check out these two platforms for your flashcard needs. And on the topic of adaptive learning, there's an online anatomy platform called KenHub that makes really good use of this principle of adapting the presentation of quiz questions according to the learner's needs. So essentially what you do on KenHub.com is you select a module like the neurovasculature of the upper extremity, and you go through a module of training where you learn, okay, where's the anterior circumflex humeral artery? Well, here it is in this view, shown in green. So that is going to be the one on the top right or the top left. So they train you up at the beginning, and then as things become progressively more difficult, these cue cards go away, and you just have four options to choose from. You get instant feedback whether you got it right or wrong, and then it will remember if you got it incorrect, so that way you get another opportunity to chime in and do that question at the very end of the module. And then analytics are employed to give you a sense of which modules you are weak at. And then there's some gamification principles where you're going to try to earn more points every time you do a module. You're going to try to increase your amount of time that you train. And then you're going to see your knowledge grow as you track the number of terms that you've learned over time. So a lot of really good pedagogical principles put into KenHub.com and many other online tools I'm sure that you could find on your own. One of the, actually the most requested classroom technology when you poll learners is lecture capture. On our campus, the vendor that we use for lecture capture is called Panopto. And here's the URL that you will go to look for all of the recorded lectures that are kind of within your courses that you're registered for. And this just gives you a sense of where it falls in terms of the percentage of respondents on a survey where students were asked, you know, what would you wish your instructors would use more of? And it's lecture capture. So it's really at the top of the list of technologies requested by students. And this is, you know, essentially what this looks like. It's highly likely that you have been through and you've seen lecture capture before. This is what Panopto looks like. You get to see the slides the presenter is going through. You can scrub through in time. You can click and you can modify the speed. And you can also change the quality of the video. And what's really nice, when the lecture hall is equipped with a document camera that's connected to the computer that has Panopto recording software on it, you can then put information underneath the document camera and have that appear in your lecture recording. So for me, at this point in time, I do all of my drawings in lecture, and I do them under the document camera instead of on the whiteboard, because then the students can see and revisit the drawings after lecture is over. Because when you think about it, there's a lot going on when I'm drawing the cranial nerves. I'm talking about a lot of different concepts as I'm drawing them, and the students have to change different colors of their pen. We have to get new paper out. It's just a lot going on, and so it's really beneficial to review the drawings at a later time. And with a document camera, you can do really cool things, like you can do a demo of something very intricate and small and blow it up for the whole class to see in the lecture, as well as later offline at home. So this is me mounting a scalpel onto a blade onto a handle. And I must say that ever since I started doing this, the number of scalpel injuries due to putting a blade on and taking a blade off has dropped dramatically. And then the lecture capture content can be digested in a lot of different ways. So you could go to the URL for Panopto, but you could also convert the Panopto lectures into podcasts. So if you're somebody that has a commute on a bus or in a carpool, then you may be interested in this, because what you can do is you can break down all of those Panopto feeds into podcast feeds, and you can load them onto your devices equipped with things like iTunes or Overcast, and you can then you can then go through these different episodes, which are then automatically downloaded to your device. And you can do them with video, you can do audio only, it's up to you. And as you might have noticed, what I'm showing you in this slide is a screenshot of a video that I put together that is on Vimeo. So you'll just search Panopto podcast subscription for Pasco on Vimeo.com, and you'll find these tutorials on how to convert your Panopto feed into a podcast feed. Another technology that you could consider integrating into your course is the building of online modules. So there's a lot of ways to add narration and guidance of the learner through complicated content. One way is what I'm doing right now, where I'm just simply adding my voice over recorded PowerPoint slides. But you could use software like Articulate Storyline, where you can create a module that allows the student to step through the content at their own pace. So you've got, you know, every one of these items here is going to be a slide in a PowerPoint, and then clicking play will then initiate the audio playback and narration of this content. And these are really effective ways of imparting information to your students before they come into class. So in a recent study performed by myself and Modern Human Anatomy colleague Lisa Lee, we found that for the group of the students, that as they went through the module, their performance or percent correct on a 10-question quiz increased from 29.5% up to 74.3%. So that's a main effect for time, comparing pre to post, suggesting that in terms of learning and performing well on a standard multiple choice quiz, having your students go through on a web-based module is really effective. And this is a very common way that faculty will construct flipped classroom experiences. I mean, that's what I'm doing for you right now. Most students in a medical curriculum were found to prepare for flipped classroom by watching web lectures. That's what I expect you to do right now. I expect you to finish this second lecture and go on to the third one and watch this ahead of our October 9th session. So here are some technologies that I'd really like to start using, but I just haven't got around to it yet. Virtual reality. This is an immersive experience where you essentially put your smartphone into all kinds of different devices. You've got anything from your $15 Google Cardboard to your $100 HTC headset, where essentially you put your phone in there and then you can immerse yourself into a 3D constructed environment, such as the transbronchial tree. Actually, that's the oral cavity, but anyway, this is an app called Anatomy U. And what Anatomy U does is it creates these 3D environments that you can put yourself in, and you can then go exploring around these different regions of the body. And this will be really helpful in just understanding the 3D spatial arrangement of anatomy. It's a really common technique used by anatomy instructors to say, okay, consider you're in the oral cavity. This is the ceiling, this is the floor, this is the lateral wall, this is the anterior wall. But it's challenging for the student to construct that 3D representation in their mind. So you could essentially do magic school bus style and virtually shrink the student down and put them within this space so they can free explore all these annotated landmarks within the oral cavity or whatever body region is of interest. So that wraps up objective number 2. We're going to finish this video right here. And we're going to then start the next one up, where I'm going to now give you some strategies to remain informed of upcoming technologies beyond this course.